Hey, it's good to be back with you. It's been a while since I've been here. Just a real quick note, a couple of you, Sharon's mom, the car mom, Kay, has been here. And she is quite limited on time in this earth, shall we say. Hospice is at our house, and at any moment now, I keep my phone right there. I expect a call when I'm away. But that's okay, because we know absolutely that she is going to be much better off when she leaves here. So we're kind of hoping that this doesn't drag out for her sake, and to see her like that is pretty traumatic. And Sharon has gone through a lot and here recently, and some of you have been through that, so you know how that goes. Appreciate the opportunity to come here. 5 o'clock in the evening cuts right in the middle of, my beauty rest in the afternoons, but that's okay. You can be different like that. Set the time that suits you. I know, didn't do me any good anyway. But I've noticed I came through 2 massive thunderstorms and traffic and up there on 85. You're taking your life in your hands in a lot of those places. And I mean to tell you, when the rain hits, the idiots come out. That's all there is to it. I mean, they're everywhere. I thought we left them behind. You know, I don't live at Lake Norman anymore. Moved up to, I thought I was going to semi-retire. That didn't work out. But working with the Northwest Congregation in Greensboro, today's been an unbelievable day. Working with David Bragg is really a joy to work with him. You need to listen to him sometime. Really a good man. And so we're kind of like teaming up there. And then today, I taught a Bible class, and I preached in the morning hour, and now I'm down here tonight. I feel like I'm back full time again, just in one day, you know. And then the elders announced today that they're going to begin a building program. They've hired the architect and ready to go. So we're excited about some things in the future there, and glad to be a part of that. Every place I've gone, including Lake Norman, we went through a building program. And that can be kind of hairy and scary at the same time, but we're looking forward to getting involved in that. We were singing that song and I couldn't help but, I didn't want to look at Dean while I was singing this song, because I just knew that he and Hillary were beaming when they probably thought this song was written about them. Fairest Lord Jesus, the song, Fair Are the Meadows. Okay? Yeah. That's a stretch. So we'll just let that one be, because you just never know what people's minds. And I love to sing. Then met Kirk. Did they know Kirk? You know Kirk Sanders? Oh, then I can say anything I want about him then. But so you understand, he loves to sing and songs. I think both of us, I think we rubbed up on each other the years that we've been together and stuff. That songs just pop into our minds when something happens. So I'm sitting there singing that Fair on the Meadows and run across the meadows. So anyway, that just happened. Open your Bibles to, and the dove. Oh, can I go there or not? Now keep my mouth shut, because they don't need this early on in their marriage. But it's good to see them, you got that arm around her and everything. You're doing it right. That's cool. And then of course Dean and Hillary, another one on the way. Boy, you guys are in for it. I can tell you some things. Raising 3 daughters, but Nora needs brother or sister. So we'll find out sometime soon. Yeah. The book of Mark. Dean asked me to say some things about, are you stopping at normal time, or do you go, to 8 or 9 o'clock? Then I'm not going to do that, because I learned a long time ago when I started preaching, get up, speak up, and shut up. And that's exactly what I do. You get it, you know, one serving and you get filled right then and there. We're not going to rehash that stuff. So I'm going to be like Mark tonight. Because when you look at the book of Mark, and this is supposed to be an introductory, so it might be a little bit boring, because I'm going to give you some bullet points. I'm going to give you some bullet points that you can remember. I don't have PowerPoints, so you're going to have to remember, or you're going to have to go the old-fashioned route, you know, it's called pen and paper, and write it down. Yep, got one of these cards here. You can use one of them too. But anyways, so I'll give you some bullet points, and then at the end, I'm going to do my traditional three points, you know, some people think, you know, you can get by on one, but I really like to give people their money's worth and go with 3 points, a lesson here at the very end, a practical thing, why Mark is so important to us today in our day and time, so we'll kind of bring it down to that. Mark is brief. Now, when I say Mark, you know who we're talking about, right? You know who? Okay, so we'll come back at it. Nora, did you say something? No. But Mark is brief. And what you have here is when you open up and you're in Mark chapter 1, we'll read here in just a minute. Mark is brief, but it is exciting because you have an emphasis here on what Jesus has done, and a whole lot less on what he has said. Does that make sense? Because this is an action letter. And it is brief. But the picture of Jesus here is very factual and it's real and it's called what he has done. In layman terms, you have Matthew, Mark, and Luke's account. It's called the Synoptic Gospel. And that means they go together. That means literally the word means seeing together. And so Matthew and Mark and Luke and you put them together. They look alike in a lot of ways. There's a lot of similarities in Matthew, Mark, Luke. But see, John hangs out there by himself. Because when John's account of the gospel is different. It's not like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. There's a lot of similarities, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but John writes differently. But you know the neat thing is you put them all together, you get the complete picture of Christ. And Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the gospel accounts, were written so that we would come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing we may have life in his name. Now that's at the end of John chapter 20 and verses 30 and 31. So the point of it is, you know, we have, and how this seems so elementary sometimes, but you stop and think about this. Stop and think about it. This is so important for us to come to grips with the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus Christ. Because in John 8 and verse 24, the scripture says, unless you believe that I am, and there's the terminology deity, I am. We're studying a great lesson. Another teacher is teaching on Sunday mornings, seven I ams. Jesus, look at John, I am the door, you know. I am the life. I am the bread of life. I am deity. The reason why he did that and showed that and the reason why we have that there is to show and to prove that Jesus is the one and only. And unless you believe in Jesus. Now, I'm not talking about superficial belief to where, yeah, I can read it. I can pronounce his name right. I even know it in Greek and Hebrew or whatever. Unless I do it. Now, I'm not talking about that. But I'm saying unless he makes a difference in your life. That's what real belief means, that you just don't put it in your head, that you just don't put his name on your lips, but you actually conform to his will. You are a transformed individual. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, John 1 and verse 14 says. Because what? John chapter 1 and verse 1, the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So believing is not, oh, he's a good man, he's a good prophet, and people have come to that conclusion. The woman at the well, she made a progression in her faith. You can see that.
John chapter 9, the man that was born blind and now he can see. There was a progression of faith in his life. His name is called Jesus. Yet could that be a prophet? And then he is the Son of God. So there's a progression. And it's the same thing with us. Our faith begins, maybe just a little seedling, but then it grows and matures. And he's not just on our lips, and he's not just in our heads and our minds, but he's in our life. And he dominates us, and he controls us. And the older we get, and incidentally, every one of you are getting old. Every one of you are getting old. Right, Nora? Say yes, shake your head. But as we get older, our spiritual growth and maturity needs to get older too. So we read about Jesus, we study about him, and we grow and we change to become more and more like him. You know, one of the I like this. See, all these notes, you can tell that I'm not reading my notes, and my wife says, "Boy, that's dangerous when you don't stick to your outline." She starts sweating and wringing her hands. What's he going to say next? But one of the things I like to do, and we've done it for years. Y'all get Reader's Digest? You've heard of that. You've heard of Reader's Digest? You've been around a while. Or you pick up Our State Magazine. I'll go right to it. I like to find out about people. I like to know what makes them tick. I like to know what they have done. I like to read character. I like to see how people do, why they do what they do. I like to hear about their accomplishments. I want to know people. My life in college days was, now I took every Bible class except Greek and Hebrew. I didn't have to do that. I really wasn't into preaching the venue, but I took sociology and psychology because I knew if I was going into ministry, I was dealing with people, and I need to know more about people. So I took a lot of psychology and sociology. I took all the Bible courses they offered, but you see, Bible study is a lifelong study. You don't stop studying the Bible. Even when you get old and you can't see, you can still hear, and you know, and if you can't hear, you put those earbuds on, you got they can pump that thing into your head. You've no excuse for not growing and maturing and reading the Bible and growing up. But I like character studies in Apollos in John chapter 18. If you ever read Apollos, you go there sometime, just short, 24 through 28. You read about Apollos, and the thing I like about Apollos, I know he was mighty in the scriptures. I got that. But here's another thing about Apollos. Apollos knew only the baptism of John, right? But you see, some couple took him aside. They didn't put him up on public display and try to belittle him because, don't have you heard about the baptism of Jesus? And then, no, he didn't hear, but he would do everything else. And they took him aside and they taught him the way of the Lord more accurately. Okay? And guess what? He didn't get mad. He didn't get upset. When he learned something new, when he learned he was doing something that was not complete, he changed. He became a very strong partner with Paul, like in Corinth. 1 Corinthians has 7 times Paulus is mentioned there. But you see, that attitude of mine needs to be what I have. I need to be willing, when I read the Bible, to conform to the Word of God. Even though I haven't been, even though I can do it, I need to change my life. Our whole life has changed. When you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you're going to read about Jesus. And guess what? Not one of us here, put us all together, we're not going to match up to his character and his nature. He's perfect. He's sinless. He's the divine Son of God. And there is no other. And we've got to come to believe in him to the point that we actually can change our life. And when you read the book of Mark, then you read the other gospel accounts, you get that complete picture of who Jesus is. Most of the scholars, that, at least the ones that I've read, they are convinced that Mark, and this is a bullet point, okay, bullet point is this. Most of the scholars that I've read about here, and I've read several of the commentaries in the beginning there, they're convinced that Mark was the earliest gospel account written. Most of them say in the 50s, early 50s. that Mark comes. You know, I know we open up and you got Matthew, Mark, but well, if you want to go chronologically, you have a chronological Bible? I challenge you to do something. You take a Bible study, you know, get on regular habit of reading it and read it chronologically. Well, your eyes are going to be open. Now, there's nothing wrong with having Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I can't sing that song if I don't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, you got the tune. So, but here you go. Mark was written first. And another bullet point is this: when we talk about Mark, this is a narrative. This is this writing here is a narrative about Jesus, and the reason why it is written is to prove his deity. But notice this: if you believe, you can't possibly be the same. Look with me here in Mark chapter 1, verse 1, right at the very first. And we don't have time, you know, this is an introductory thing, and Dave didn't give me any really hard, fast rules, so I'm a liberty, so I'm making my own way here. But in Mark chapter 1, because you're going to have other speakers coming, and they're going to be taking different parts of Mark. And so, but here's an introductory. Mark chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning of the gospel. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's what we have here. Now just keep that in mind. Slide down here to verse 15. Slide down to verse 15. The time was fulfilled. You know, well, John was arrested. Jesus came into Galilee, verse 14 says, proclaiming the gospel of God. Okay? Verse 1. Saying, the time was fulfilled and the kingdom of God, I'll say something about the kingdom of God in just a few minutes. The kingdom of God is at hand. Get this. Repent and believe in the gospel. That's the challenge here. Mark was written here to prove the deity of Jesus and to cause people to want to transform their life. To repent means to change. And so this whole is John Mark, but Mark here begins, and his goal here is to give us this information. But it's not just to inform, it is to transform us, to change us. Now, I know that's true of other accounts, and that's true of the basic concept of, well, we've got the divine word of God. But I look at, you know, very briefly, like right in the very beginning in chapter 1, and I read in verses 9 through 11, you are my beloved son, verse 11, with you I am well pleased. Well, that is something that the Son wanted to do. He wanted to please the Father. Remember, he said at one time, it's not my will, but your will be done. Well, and that should be our attitude too. We should want to please the Heavenly Father. I keep on reading, and I read about how that he was tempted there, verse 12, in the wilderness, and Jesus overcame temptation. He was tempted in all points, like we are, the Hebrew writer says, yet without sin. But the way he dealt with it, how he handled, also encourages us in handling temptation. I look down here, and we just read 14, 15, that the gospel here was something that needed to be taught. Christianity is a taught religion. You've heard older preachers than me have said that. It is a taught religion. It needs to be taught. It needs to be expounded upon. And so the gospel is something that must be taught. That's what Jesus did. He went about. What did he do? He taught the people. And people were astounded at his speaking ability. It wasn't just his speaking ability. It was that he commanded. He had the authority, and it became obvious to him. And even some have said, there is no one that has spoken like him. Soldier said that. So I look at this first chapter here and I see that. I see Jesus taught the gospel. I look down here and I see how that he challenged those who would come after him. There's a call. One of the important parts here in Mark chapter 8 is your call for discipleship. We'll get to that in a minute too. But he challenged those disciples here, and he challenges us right there in verse 17. Follow me, and I will make you. He didn't say, I'll make you fishers of men. He said, I'll make you to become fishermen, because it's a process you go through. You don't wake up one morning after your baptism and you are a solid follower of Jesus and you're on your, I mean, you're moving 90 miles an hour. No way. It's a process, and a transformation takes place, and time is involved. And sometimes we get a little bit impatient with ourselves. And we get a little impatient with one another, you know. But Jesus challenges, I mean, his word challenges us, and we challenge one another. Brother to brother, sister to sister, we challenge each other to live right and to become, in this particular case, and follow me and I'll make you to become, he said, fishers of men. And then you read a little bit later in 21 and 22. 22 says that he taught them as one who had authority. He taught with authority. He could do that because he has the truth and he's the embodiment of the truth. So Mark is a narrative about Jesus to prove his deity here. And then another thing that we need to know, you need to know the author. This is another bullet point. The author is John Mark. The mother is named Mary. And don't get shook up with that. And Jesus wasn't the only Jesus during his day and time, okay? But his name is Jesus, common name. Mary, his mother, common name. But Mary's a widow as well. And if you remember, you know, stick your finger in Mark and come on back to the book of Acts. Let's just read about his home. But in Acts chapter 12 and verse 12 through 17, we see that the church met in their home. They didn't have nice buildings like this. They didn't have the pews, okay, sticking together in the concrete. They didn't have concrete. There's a lot of differences today, but they met in people's homes. And notice in verse 12, and this is from Peter. He's let out of prison. Angel comes, releases him, gets out of prison. And he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name is Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. So he knocks on the door. Rhoda comes to the door. She's all excited about what she sees. Peter continued knocking and let him in. And then he departs. He says, you go tell the brethren these things, what has happened to me. So early on, the church is meeting in Mary's home, and her son is John Mark. He's the writer of this gospel account. We know him as Mark. It's John Mark. Now, here's another bullet point that you need to know. Another bullet point, this John Mark, this is the one who was with Paul on that first missionary journey. This is the one who was with Paul. And Paul later, Paul and Barnabas, and my own terminology, he had a complaint about John Mark. And there was, as the old King James says, there was no small disagreement. In other words, it was a blow-up about whether or not you're going to take John Mark. Of course, John Mark and Barnabas are, the cousins. And Barnabas took Mark and Paul. They went on their separate ways. But not only did Paul at that time have a complaint about Mark, but later on he has a compliment about Mark. He didn't hold a grudge or anything like that, but Paul was pretty much a guy. He got something in his mind, and that was pretty much it. I could see him being like that, especially when you know a little bit about his background. Some of the historical writings that were written later about Paul, I can see that. But John Mark is the one who is the writer here. He was with Paul, but Paul didn't hold anything against him. I mean, Mark had some growing up to do, like we all do. Matter of fact, later on, and is it 1 Timothy? I think it's 1 Timothy. I have to stop. No, it's 2 Timothy. I think it's 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 11. He says, you know, Paul's in prison. He says, you go get Mark because he's going to be helpful to me. So I think that that's important to recognize who the writer is. There is also, and I say this with a little bit of, you know, I don't usually interject things that are outside of Scripture, but I think it's important to note that a lot of history about, we'll just say external evidence points to the fact that John Mark and Peter were very close together. John Mark, matter of fact, a lot of things that John Mark writes about here, I've even heard people say, well, he got that from Peter. And he might have. He might have wrote down some things that he got from Peter. Of course, he's writing by inspiration. But evidently, at least from a historical standpoint, Mark and Peter are close. And if you go back to 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 13, Peter calls John Mark my son. I heard Dean as I was walking in here say something. Did you say something about the spiritual father? Yeah, I'm your dad. You feel forgiven. But you have a spiritual relationship here that's close, and spiritual father, spiritual son. And so I can see that. I can see that when I look at the writings. And you stop, think about it. When Peter, and what we just read in Acts 12, when Peter was released from prison, whose house did he go to? He went to Mark's house, John Mark's house. That's where he went. And here's something else. Just throw this in here too for 2 cents worth. You stop and think about this. Both Peter and Mark, both of these guys, there's some similar things. That's just like Dean. I'll pick on Dean tonight. He's okay. He's pickable, okay? I mean, you didn't take it on to figure that one out. But see, both Dean and I, we have a little bit of similarity in our background. You know, both of us were in the military. And both of us appreciate the game of golf, you know, even though it does take us to the cleaner sometimes. And there's some similarities, and we appreciate one. What you stop and think about this. Here you go. Peter denied the Lord 3 times. Right? But he was restored and became a valuable asset. Right? Okay, here's John Mark. John Mark. Okay, he messed up with Paul. I don't know what he did with this. I don't know. But guess what? He also found restoration. I mean, he was a valuable asset to Paul later on. You know, go get him. He's going to be helpful to me. So I can see that, you know, with the closeness of Peter and Mark here, and even some of the writings. Maybe some of the other guys will bring something out. You know, hey, that sounds like Peter to me, because there are some things in here that say, well, Peter could have easily said that as well. So with that external evidence and a couple of biblical things here, you put that together, and you can see how both Peter and Mark, both of them experienced failure, and both of them experienced restoration. Mark's picture of Jesus is pretty much to the point and real easy. And in chapter 1 and verse 1, we see the picture of Jesus and his person. Who is he? Well, he's described as the Son of God. Now, he's no doubt he's the Son of Man, no doubt deity. He is fully human and he's fully divine. But Mark pictures him as his person. But not only just the person, the Son of God, who he is, but Mark, and this is captured all throughout the book of Mark. He focuses on his work. I mean, what we say earlier when we started, the focus here is on what Jesus did and less of what he said. In other accounts, you'll have a lot of this is what the Lord said. But when you go read in the book of Mark, you'll see the focus. This is what the Lord did. And that's what Mark focuses in on. The emphasis that he makes in, I'll just look at it real quick with you. It's Mark chapter 8.
there is this emphasis. And I remember having a series one time in another congregation on becoming a servant of Christ and a follower of him in discipleship. And I remember using this passage a lot. But Mark chapter 8, verse 34 through the end of the chapter is an important section that, and I'm sure one of the other guys will bring this out, is an important section on discipleship here. It's important that we understand discipleship and follow. Jesus is not looking for just intellectual believers. He is looking for disciples, learners, and followers. Are you willing to go the distance? Are you willing to follow him every step of the way? He's not looking for any casual walk. And where he leads, some of the areas kind of rough. Are you willing to stick with him through the thick and the thin? Now I'm going to close with this, and I did say close, so that kind of gives you a hint that I'm ready to wind down. We're not going to midnight as Dean wants me to go. I'm all close with these three points. When I look at Mark, you know, I think one of the things you said, you know, or I forget your exact wording, but the impression I got of was, well, what does all this mean to me? Looking at this, what benefit do I derive as a member of the body of Christ, as a follower of him? What do I gain that would be helpful in my walk here? Well, the first thing is an obvious because it's all through the book of Mark and the other accounts too, is these miracles that Jesus did. These miracles testify to his deity. And I know when you come to Mark 16 and verse 20 that the signs and wonders that were done by the early, they were done to confirm the spoken word. I got that. But these miracles were done not so people would stand back and say, "Hey, that was a great show. I like that, you know. Walking on water. How'd you do that?" I remember a camp one time. There was a guy out there named Tim Pinkston. And he walked on water. And he tried to fool everybody. Of course, everybody knew he couldn't walk on water. But he had right underneath the surface of the water these boards. And boy, he had to hit them or he's going down.